for Poltimore, in 2013, auctions for the old masters reached 1 billion euros, more or less. This figure is less than 1 week's sales for contemporary art in New York. Are the old masters out?
No, I don't think the old masters are out at all. And I slightly dispute your figures. But old masters, the problem with old masters, of course, is that it gets more and more difficult to find the very best, because every time you sell one, or a major piece, it either goes into a museum or goes into a major private collection where it might not come out again for another 20 or 30 years. So the sourcing of old masters is definitely more difficult than it's ever been. And I think the whole world's become much more contemporary. So, you know, people are still painting. The contemporary artists are painting, so it's creating more. But we've never sold $1 billion of old masters, I'm afraid. That would be wonderful if we did, but we've never reached that sort of figure.
We have a speaker here from Barnaby's, which is an online search engine for auctions worldwide. Do you think there will be an online auction house functioning similarly to eBay, with focus on major pieces of art, which therefore point to a shift perhaps in the way buyers are searching or actually buying, obviously, their art?
I think we must never underestimate the internet capability, and I think we'd be crazy not to use everything the internet brings. And it absolutely is something that's used by the younger generation all the time. So if we ignore it, we ignore it at our peril. But I just put this thought in your mind. If you are selling a £20 million Picasso, would you give it to an internet business? Or would you give it to an established auction house where you know that, you know, it has a clientele and is used to selling these things? You know, it's less of a risk. I'm not saying that we can necessarily do any better, but it'd be less of a risk. And therefore, at the moment, for major works of art, people would sell by the traditional methods. But the internet, I think, is going to be fascinating to watch, and every year it's going to get stronger, I'm sure.
And as an auctioneer, have you seen a shift in more or less the ambience that you find in the auction in itself, as far as an increase in telephone bidders, an increase in online bids that come in?
Well, definitely we have more online bids than ever before. It depends on the sort of type of sale you're doing. If you're doing a wine sale, you probably get more online bids because it's multiples, or a print sale, where you can buy similar works or identical works at other
Sure.
times. But if you're looking at our big impressionist sales, there's less and less online bids. But it's definitely increased over the years. The telephones are still hugely important to us. But we love it when people actually come to the rooms, and then we can try and, you know, it's a show. So we have to engage with them. And sometimes we can get them to bid more than they wanted to. So
of course.
It's a bit of fun.
It's an intangible that's just
who knows?
In the room.
And it's a show. So if you make it fun, people then want to spend money. And that's always my job, is to make it amusing.
Like the Picasso that was sold in early May.
I know. I mean, that was pretty amazing.
What is behind such a big bid like this? Is it still the romantic notion of owning such a piece, or is it really the investment?
Well, gosh, it's so difficult to say. I mean, I think a lot of people say 180 million, what a crazy price. But I remember when people said 90 million was a crazy price for a work of art. So, you know, it's all relative, and I think people should be free to spend their money. I think in this case, on the Picasso, you know, we've seen major museums around the world, perhaps new museums, who want to establish themselves on the international market. They've got lots of money, and therefore, you know, they're happy to spend over the odds, maybe, or whatever it is, for that key piece to get people to come to their museum. These are brand new museums that are interested. Plus, you've got some very rich private clients who also would love this object. Whether they're buying it for love or for investment or for decoration, who knows? But does it matter?
No. This is your first time at La Zagaleta, then?
No.
No, that's right. You were here
earlier last year.
That's right.
Yes, yes.
So what is your impression, would you say, of La Zagaleta the second time around?
Well, it's incredible. I mean, it's an oasis, isn't it, really? And that's what's so beautiful about it. And you're in this lovely sort of dreamland, really. Perfect.
Yes, and for tomorrow's event for Foro La Zagaleta, what do you expect to, as a speaker yourself, hope to get out of the experience?
Well, I think it's a great forum for meeting people, sharing ideas. I mean, we've already talked to a whole group of people that I probably would have never met, you know, doing what I do. And it's just fascinating to hear their views on my business and vice versa. So I think it's always good to chat and keep one's eyes open for the future, you know. And, you know, we get quite sort of stuck in our own ways, especially when you get to my age. You get stuck in your own ways and you think that the way of doing business is the only way. But actually, if someone comes along and says, perhaps you should do it this way, you think, why the hell didn't I think of that earlier? So this is, for me, very important, and that's why I'm here, and it's lovely to be here.
Well, great. We're very thankful to have you here, and we hope you have a nice day tomorrow, and thank you so much.
Pleasure.